Okay. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Abram.
Today, Sunday in May, is Children's Sunday. And for Children's Sunday, Alex and I, two children. Hello? Okay. All right. So Alex and I will be bringing you the message this morning. Yes, you can sit. Sorry. Alex?
All right, so morning, church. So today's topic for our sermon is, why should we believe in the resurrection of Christ? Why should we? It's a question that many people always discuss with others. So, in starting this sermon, we're actually going to play a short video. Sister Jenalee Johnson, she made the video. It was very well done. So, have a look at it as it plays on the screen.
Resurrection?
Oh, you mean resurrection? Well, you know that Jesus was killed and he was buried. On the third day, when some of his friends went to the grave, it was empty. The body was gone. An angel told one of the ladies that Jesus had risen from the dead. He had resurrected. That big word.
So, you mean he could walk and talk again?
Yes.
I would be afraid of him. He must be like a ghost.
No, he was not a ghost. He was like a real person again. He ate with them. He even asked one of his disciples to touch him, to make sure that he was real and not a ghost.
I would still be afraid.
Jesus always told us that we must not be afraid, because he would always be with us. He's there to hear our prayers, Anna. We are free to talk to him because he died for us. He has now freed us from our sins.
Will we see him again?
Yes, because he is now in heaven. He has made it possible for us also to go to heaven and be with him.
How can I go to heaven?
We must believe in him, to trust him, and to live good lives, and try not to do bad things.
I would love to go to heaven, Grandma. See Jesus. I will try very hard to be good.
That's very good, Anna.
Bye, Grandma!
Okay. Yes. So, after watching that video, you may have taken a few points from it. So let's take one. What is the resurrection? Well, we read it every Sunday. It's in our Nicene Creed, page 104 in the Book of Common Prayer. It said, in the fourth stanza, it said, he suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the scriptures. That's the main piece that we want to take from the Nicene Creed. So, let's dive into what is the resurrection message about. Well, the Feast of the Resurrection, or Easter Sunday, is the most significant festival in the Christian calendar. The resurrection message is a message of hope, a message of restoration. We believe that God raised Jesus from the dead on the third day after his burial. In fact, the resurrection is the greatest miracle in the Bible. The resurrection gave us new believers a new lease on life, because forgiveness is now available to every single person on this planet. For the believer, there is life after death here on earth. There is hope in the life thereafter, a hope that this life is not the end of our existence, a hope that we are in a state of transition and that there is life beyond what we're experiencing currently, a belief that our life after death will be restored to a life of purity, essentially a sinless life as God intended. The resurrection message assures us that we can achieve the same transformation as Jesus did after his resurrection the third day after his passing. So why should we believe in the resurrection message? So let me ask you first off, how do we even benefit from the message of the resurrection of Christ if we do not believe? If we believe, then our daily actions in our life must show likewise. The creeds that we recite during the Eucharist confesses that we believe in the resurrection, as I read earlier, a line earlier. It said every Sunday. Our faith is built on this belief. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, chapter 14, and I quote, "And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith." The basis that our belief must be that Jesus died, was buried, and was raised from the dead. Why should we still believe in it, you may ask? Well, there's evidence that he was seen by many people. Mary saw him, the 11 disciples. Even Thomas was invited to touch him. That's piece of evidence as to why we should believe in the resurrection. I was doing some searching last night, and I found that 1 Corinthians 15, chapters 12 to 19, really speak about the resurrection in detail as to why we as Christians should believe in the resurrection. So let me read it for you. "But if it is preached that Christ has been raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless, and so is your faith. More than that, we are then able to be false witnesses about God, for we have testified about God that he has raised Christ from the dead, but he did not raise him, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied." Why does the resurrection matter? Well, if Jesus hadn't been raised from the dead, there would be no hope of awakening for those who have fallen asleep in Christ. Now, falling asleep in Christ is a euphemism for death. Simply put, without the resurrection, us as Christians would be just as pitiful. We'd be wretched, sad, misled people who gave up everything for a false hope. But because we do believe in the resurrection, our faith is full of meaning, purpose, and value, real value. And there is hope beyond just this life we're living currently. Now, brothers and sisters, that's just the biblical side to this sermon. Let's put this into a real world scenario, shall we? Abram, over to you.
Thank you very much, Alex, for giving us the biblical side. And as he rightly said, I would like to compare believing in the resurrection message to... believing in the resurrection message to... I would like to offer a mundane example that I think can be compared to believing in the resurrection message. And I know my mother is going to appreciate this one. I didn't tell her anything that I was preparing for this sermon. So what is he going to say? What you're thinking? What's he going to say next? Life insurance. you couldn't have guessed that, right? Life insurance. Why do people buy life insurance? And don't worry, Father, this is not going to be a seminar about life insurance. I'm going to link it to the topic, but bear with me. So for those of you who don't know, my mother, Catherine Marrett, is a top life insurance sales representative. And having lived with her for the duration of her life insurance career, I'd say I'm well equipped to discuss why people buy life insurance, right? So let's talk about the people who maintain life insurance, because it's not a one-off purchase. It's something you have to maintain on a monthly basis, right? Right, Dion? Right. The people who maintain life insurance policies are certain about two things. They are certain that one day they will die. The second thing they are certain about is that when that day comes, they want their loved ones to be taken care of. Okay? And so each month they work hard, they earn money, and they contribute, they sacrifice a portion of money towards their life insurance policies, right? So they're certain about these two things. They don't know when they're going to die, but they know that they will die, and they know that when that day comes, their families will be taken care of, because each month they make a sacrifice and maintain their policies. Okay, Abram, life insurance is cool, but why should we believe in the resurrection message? Believing in the resurrection message is your own life insurance policy. But you are the beneficiary. So it's like the best kind of life insurance policy, right? Because you actually get to benefit from the policy itself. Now, I think we can agree that we too are certain about these same two things. Except the second one is a little different. But the first one, for sure, the first certainty is that we will all one day die, right? And the second one, I can only speak for myself, but I think all of us would like to be taken care of once we pass. You know, we want to be in a nice place once we die. And so when we believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that is us, in essence, signing the papers, you know, to our life insurance policy. But remember, we have to maintain the policy. So it's not a one-off purchase. It's something you have to maintain. Would you agree that when you believe in the resurrection, it is implied that you believe many, if not all, of the other teachings of the Bible? And specifically, I'm referring to instructions on how we are to live our lives as Christians, right? As people who believe in the resurrection of Christ. The teachings that, such as the fruit of the Spirit, right? That we're to, each month we focus on the fruit of the Spirit and living our lives to embody what a Christian should be, right? A hymn I will never forget, thanks to Father Allen, Canon Allen, is hymn number 44. Is it 445, Father? They will know you are Christians by your love. 445, is it? Well, it's not in it. Oh, okay, my apologies. But what I'm trying to say is, once you believe in the resurrection, you know that to receive the benefits of the life insurance policy, you have to live your life a certain way from month to month. And so instead of the, unlike the mundane life insurance policy that you have to pay money each month, the sacrifices you make each month are every day you make a commitment with yourself and with God to live a certain way. You give up certain things, and that is your monthly contribution. So this, I think the resurrection message can be compared to a life insurance policy. Right? That's the message I'd like to bring across. So that's my take. So you should believe in the resurrection message because you are certain that one day you will die. And after you die, you want to be taken care of. So once you sign your papers and you wholeheartedly believe, each month you make your sacrifices, you live your life the way God intends us to live. And at the end of the day, you know, you'll be taken care of. So that's all from me today, guys. But I hope you can appreciate the example that I prepared. So, Alex, unless you have any further comments, we can close it off here today.
Well, no, but yes, for all the children that are watching today's service, given that today is Children's Sunday, I hope that this sermon has really opened your eyes to see and understand in a much simpler way why we should believe in the resurrection message. And that's all for the sermon today. Thank you.
Before we stand for the Nicene Creed or the Apostles' Creed, permit me to just say two comments. Well, first of all, I'm speaking for myself, but I'm sure that I can speak for many of us here, that we feel like Simeon this morning, in that having heard Brother Alex and Brother Abram, we can say, Lord, let us know thy servant, depart in peace. For our eyes have seen and heard the glory of the Lord. So we give God thanks for them, for their parents, and indeed for the Ascension family who have nurtured them so that this morning they could say, give that testimony. So I give God thanks for that. And I would want to suggest on the basis of what they have said that in the same way we did for Brother Paul Scott's presentation some time ago, if we could lift that out of the today's live streaming, today's broadcast, because I think that that message is something for us to share with anybody we know who is terminally ill. It's a message to be shared with anybody we know who has is struggling with what happens to their loved ones when they die. Death has occurred, and will they see their loved ones again? I think it's a message to be shared with those who will have to face death because they are standing up for a principle. And is it worth standing up for? And it's just worth sharing with somebody who wants to appreciate what resurrection is all about. And I think they have said it and done it better than any, well, as good as any theologian, clergy person could have said and done it. So I leave that for our prayerful consideration, especially under mark of mission number one. So, this is why we are here Sunday after Sunday, to proclaim the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ and the hope that it brings. And so, as I said, liturgy simply, a repeat, the whole liturgy really repeats that recurring theme. And so, as we stand, as we're able to sing, the Apostles' Creed, it's a reinforcement of our belief in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God that has made it possible. So let us stand as we're able and sing hymn 561.